at inviting fantastic external artists, curators, art historians, etc., and you are enjoying them all. But then I sometimes asked, we want to know what your people are up to. So today is a chance for you to catch up with what we do. And for TrAIN, we have sort of certain strong points, and some of them are around Asia and so on, and another one is around Latin America, particularly Brazil. And the head of Mafia is today's speaker of that branch. Dr. Michael Asbury is a reader with us, and he's a member. He's a member of our TrAIN Research Center. And now he's going to talk about Hélio Oiticica.
Thank you very much, Toshio. Actually, before I start, I'm going to play a track which hopefully will become obvious why I played it once I start. But
Vieira, conselheiro de Bichote, super-ouro.
Cinema Novo by Caetano Veloso and Gilberto Gil from the Tropicália 2 album of 1993, celebrating 25 years since the launch of the album Tropicália, O Panis e Circenses, which arguably revolutionized Brazilian popular music. Here, 25 years later, we find Caetano and Gil tracing the history of Cinema Novo as music and poetry, as an example of the breaking down of social divisions within subject matter, between high arts and popular culture, in short, as a way of invoking Tropicália music as image. The opening lines of the song are revealing. I'll translate it into English. Film would like to say, I am samba, the voice of the slum, or the favela, tore up the cinema screen and begun to configure visions of great and small things that were formative and continue to inform us. The scene invoked in Caetano and Gil's song could not be clearer. The opening credits for what is generally considered the inaugural Cinema Novo film. The opening credits for the, which is generally considered the inaugural Cinema Novo film, Rio 40 Graus, by Nelson Pereira dos Santos, released in 1955, accompanied by Zequete's classic samba, A Voz do Morro, the voice of the favela, or the voice of the slum. During the credits, the camera flies over Rio de Janeiro's south zone, the Zona Sul, the wealthy quarter, from the Sugarloaf to Leblon, until cutting briskly through the clouds, ripping through the white screen, as the song implies, and arriving at Zona Norte, the north zone and the poorer area of the city, at an alleyway in a favela. So I'll show you just the opening credits of the film.
Thank you.
In associating samba with cinema, the tropicalists remember their own formative years, their influence, namely bossa nova, concrete poetry, the 60s pop, popular, and counterculture. Not that this association of music and cinema benefited in any way from hindsight. Already in 1967, and this was a significant year as we will see, Augusto de Campos emphasized the cinematographic character of Gilberto Gil and Caetano Veloso's songs by citing fellow concrete poet Décio Pignatani, and I quote Augusto de Campos. As Décio Pignatani had observed, whilst Gil's lyrics remember Eisenstein's montages with its close-ups and fusions, Caetano's lyrics are like a handheld camera, more like the open and informal way of a Godard, collecting the casual reality between facts and names, end quote. The conjunction with Eisenstein and Godard is not a casual one. We find Pignatari and, by extension, Augusto de Campos constructing a theoretical frame that would posit Tropicália as a radically innovatory, through its openness to international trends and styles, and forcefully associating it with left-wing politics and sustaining a deep indebtedness to Brazilian cultural history. It is not difficult to see how, at that time, these would seem to many irreconcilable attributes. As Celso Favarito has argued, Brazilian popular music was policed not by the dictatorship, although this would become a fact following the decree in late 1968 of the Institutional Act No. 5, but until that point, by the self-declared enlightened middle classes who submitted music, particularly that being presented at the music festivals, to a rigid criteria that demanded political engagement and association with national traditions, often these being assumed to be synonymous. The poet Augusto de Campos, in The Heat of the Hour, thus tries to bridge the aesthetic with the political in light of Caetano and Gil's perceived ambivalent engagement with both politics and nationalism, or to borrow an expression from Homi Bhabha, their ambivalence with nation and narration. Writing in the wake of the highly politically charged Opinion Theatre musical play that brought musicians Zecchetti, the composer of the samba that opened the film I just showed, Rio 40 Graus, bossa nova composer João do Valle, and singer Nara Leão, under theatre direction by Augusto Boal, who would later develop the concept of the theatre of the oppressed. In 1966, we find Augusto de Campos adding a political dimension to Caetano and Gil's music by quoting Marx and Engels, no less, in order to sustain that the intercommunicability of mass media leads to the impossibility of narrow national canons. In other words, arguing that political engagement demanded transnational perspectives within cultural production. The interconnection of distinct media thus went, at that moment, hand in hand with the mapping of cultural territories and an attempt, at least at a rhetorical level, at purporting multiple contamination as a means of undermining strict nationalist canons. Augusto de Campos posits bossa nova as the first step in a process that brought music out of its folkloristic cupboard and into an active participation with poetry, visual arts, and architecture. Here, an early example of the historical construction that would come to dominate the production of contemporary art in Brazil begins to emerge. Quoting Augusto de Campos once more, and here he's referring to this slide here, which are actually the lyrics of a song by Caetano and Gil called Bate Macumba. So, quoting Augusto de Campos, the modernity of Caetano and Gil's text, and note that he's talking about text, not music, the modernity of Caetano and Gil's text has led many to approach them with the concrete poets. A point of connection between the two groups is without a doubt Oswald de Andrade. Instead of macumba para turistas, or macumba for tourists, macumba being the Afro-Brazilian religion, so instead of macumba for tourists, as Osvaldo had condemned, we have bachi macumba for futurists, end quote. And so references to North American pop culture and Afro-Brazilian religion meet through the invocation of art history, that of modernismo brasileiro and Italian futurism. The association with Oswald de Andrade also recalls the very origin of the name Tropicália, which emerged not in music, but in art, from the conjunction of the favela hut and mass media in Hélio Oiticica's environment exhibited at the New Brazilian Objectivity exhibition at Rio's Museum of Modern Art in 1967. In the catalog, Oiticica wrote a manifesto-like essay entitled General Scheme of the New Objectivity, in which he claimed to have invoked, and I quote, Oswald de Andrade and the meaning of anthropophagy, or cultural cannibalism, as an important element in this attempt at national characterization. On the installation itself, Oiticica stated, and I quote, the created environment was obviously tropical, like something hidden away in a backyard, and most importantly, one had the feeling of treading upon earth. This sensation I had felt previously walking through the hills of the favela, and even the trajectory of entering, leaving, and winding through Tropicália's corridors is strongly reminiscent of walks through the favela hill, end quote. Oh, sorry, it continues. The participant comes into contact with a multiplicity of experiences and that refer to the image, tactility, furnished by elements available for manipulation, playfulness, and the purely visual, until one arrives at the end of the labyrinth, in the dark where a television is permanently switched on. The image absorbs the participator in the global accretion of information, end quote. If, sorry, if in Rio 40 Graus, the camera flies over Rio to arrive at the alley in a favela, Oiticica presented the viewers with the task of winding themselves into a labyrinthine structure reminiscent of a favela hut in order to be confronted with a television set. The beautiful aesthetics of neo-realist cinema, cinema novo, is transformed into the brutal meta-reality of the installation. 2 years later, in 1969, Edward Pope, who met Oiticica in London during the Whitechapel experience, discussed the contemporaneous happenings that the Exploding Galaxy group called forms of transmedia, stating that, and I quote Pope, whereas the psychedelic shows at the UFO club called themselves multimedia, where they would project some Mark Boyle-like light shows onto the Pink Floyd or the Soft Machine, the idea of transmedia is that one media acts on or becomes a metaphor for the other. So for instance, you wouldn't think of writing a poem just in black and white. You'd immediately think it's made of letters, which are visual constructions, and the sound would have a pitch, and so on, end quote. Returning to Caetano's borrowing of the name Tropicália, this would not have seemed such an outrageous thing at the time. The name Opinião, after all, had been borrowed from theater, becoming the title of a series of exhibitions organized at Rio's Museum of Modern Art. In the first of which, Opinião 65, Oiticica famously inaugurated his Parangolés, his first transmedia work, one could say. Opinião immediately provided a politicized context for the exhibitions, giving them an association with the theater play, which I mentioned before. Reviews of the show, of the Opinião 65 show, emphasized the opinionated position its opinionated position. Despite what happened with the Parangolés themselves, when inhabitants from the favela, the Mangueira favela, would have been invited, who had been invited by Oiticica to wear and dance with the Parangolés, as you can see in the image, were kind of forcibly expelled from the museum by apprehensive staff. So the following year, Opinion 66 took place, and in 1967, the same kind of series of exhibitions, it was decided that would be kind of renamed as a New Brazilian Objectivity, adopting, by the very changing name, a standpoint closer to that of a manifesto. Given that Caetano Veloso appropriated the name Tropicália from Oiticica's installation, or environment, as it was then called, it is perhaps fitting that the tropicalist musicians chose to remember their formative years through a media other than music. Cinema provides the all the narrative ingredients for such a mapping, linking aesthetics, history, politics, and above all, a depiction of the territories, whether spatial, social, or cultural. Art borrows from musical theater, only for music to borrow back from art. All this remembered by the invocation of another media, or perhaps the synthesis of all these cinema. Another precedent within this notion of transmedia that I'm playing with here, as being a driving force in 1960s cultural production in Brazil, would be the conference held during the 1957 first national exhibition of concrete art, when poets, the brothers Haroldo de Campos and Augusto de Campos, disagreed with Ferreira Goulart about the visual nature of concrete poetry. The event was reported, as you can see in the slide, in the O Cruzeiro magazine as the rock and roll of poetry, where the young Hélio Oiticica can be perceived listening attentively, if somewhat bemused, to the heated debate ensuing. As far as Oiticica is concerned, the article now seems somewhat prophetic, given his inroads into prose as a form of art in the late 60s when he was a resident at Sussex University, and which he called Autos and Contos. The conjunction of his interest during the 1970s while living in New York, namely rock and roll and experimental music, ranging from the Rolling Stones, Jimi Hendrix, to John Cage, and how these diverse sources ultimately led to his concept of quasi-cinema, had been fostered by his friendship and correspondence with a number of Brazilian musicians, artists, intellectuals, filmmakers, and poets, including, of course, the Campos brothers. In his essay, In the White Forest, Gonzalo Aguilar explores how Oiticica and the Campos brothers had, by the 1970s, transcended the old concrete, neo-concrete disagreements through, amongst other reasons, their common ties of friendship with the tropicalist musicians and the invocation of Joaquim de Souza Andrade's narrative poem, Geisa Errante, which I like to translate as the errant geezer, but it's probably an approximation. And the narrative poem, Geisa Errante of 1877, which the Campos brothers brought out of obscurity in the 1960s, particularly in relation to Canto 10, which was denominated by the Campos as the Hell in Wall Street, or Inferno in Wall Street, which they saw as being an example of proto-modernist poetry. Perhaps there is here further reference to Brazilian literary modernism through the association of the trans-historical nomadism of the character Macunaíma in Mário de Andrade's novel, which is, I think, from the late 20s, I can't remember, I think 28 maybe, that irreverently traces the political ethnic formation of Brazil. So in Souza Andrade's 19th century poem, the character, which was originally brought up as a kind of pre-Columbian kind of sacrificial being, kind of wanders across the whole of Latin America, ending up in New York. So I see a similarity with Mario Andrade's Macunaíma narrative in that sense. And here at the top, there is a little extract from the 19th century poem from the Canto 10, in which the brothers found a kind of, well, they assumed it to be kind of proto-modernist in character. Oiticica became enthusiastic about Sousa Andrade's character and his incursions through the 19th century in New York, and attempted to identify the places described by Sousa Andrade with the aid of a study of the history of the city that his friend Dori Ashton had conducted. And Oiticica, by now, by the 70s, was living in New York. This project became for him a form of transcultural and transhistorical mapping of his new city. So Sousa Andrade's 19th century New York, Mallarmé and Coudoudé, the Brazilian artist Antonio Dias, and Mario Montes in drag as Carmen Miranda, come together in Oiticica's unfinished film, Agrippina e Roma Manhattan, a title that he directly appropriated from the poem, from the 19th century poem, as you can see in the extracts I placed in the slide. So Oiticica's come together in Oiticica's unfinished film as a synthesis of poetry, literature, art, and popular culture. Above all, it demonstrates how the artist reconsidered his relation to place, since to invoke the favela could hardly sustain the claim of relating his art to life, since now he was living in New York. So music, image, and theater become instrumental in this process of relation and re-evaluation. Haroldo de Campos would, in fact, have a profound influence on Oiticica's own re-evaluation of his practice towards the end of his short life, during and after his seven-year exile in New York. Recently arrived in Manhattan, Oiticica interviewed Haroldo de Campos in 1971, establishing what would become a recurrent practice of recording conversations with his guests, which Haroldo, from the outset, entitled Heliotapes. This first recording registers Haroldo de Campos speaking of Hélio's ninhos, his nests, and these are two examples, whose concept had originated during Hélio's residency at Sussex University in Brighton in 1969, then exhibited at MoMA's information exhibition in 1970, and finally integrated Oiticica's own living environment in his New York lofts, which he renamed Babylonests. Haroldo, in the tape recording, associated the ninhos with the, and now Toshio might have to help me here, the Agomoro, it's a Japanese name. Anyway, okay, so. Haroldo, in the tape recording, associated the, it's no theater. So Haroldo in the tape recording associated the ninhos with the Agomoro play from the traditional Japanese no theater. And according to Haroldo de Campos, and here I found an image on the internet, which I'm not sure, I couldn't read the, so according to Haroldo de Campos, I was thinking about that thing we saw at your studio the other day, the nests. I came out of there and began thinking about a series of things that interested me in this very idea of yours. I was remembering a play from the Japanese no theater, the Agomoro, the Feathered Mantle, which is one of the plays Ezra Pound translated into English, a short play, very beautiful, where precisely at the center of the play is a feathered mantle that at one and the same time is beautifully colored and has fragrance. A wonderful perfume. That at that moment, presented already the issue of synesthesia, or synesthesia in English, the correspondence between sound, colors, and I would add also dance, end quote. In the play, the feathered mantle is left upon a tree like the most beautiful nests, after having been momentarily discarded by an angel. It is found by a fisherman who demands from the angel a dance in return for the mantle, the dance of the moon. Upon performing the dance, the angel discovers, dissolves into the sky, in Haroldo's words, I quote, dissolves into the sky's white, like the nest, white on the most white of whites, end quote. There is no doubt that these associations made by the poet had a great impact on the artist, not least for their reference to Oiticica's hero, Malevich. Evidence of which can be found in several notes and typed texts produced by Oiticica during the period, and which he entitled Aglomerado. He intended to publish these notes, but never got around to it. In one such example, entitled Bodywise of September 1973, 2 years after the initial recording, we find Oiticica returning to Haroldo's observations and expanding on them. From the outset, Oiticica claims, and I quote, sight loses him, the angel, in a visual sensorial performance. Haroldo gave me this translated fragment as a reference that he establishes with the effect of the nests in New York, the Babylon nests, the feathered mantle, an already sensorial plumed performer, dissolves into the sky of white on white sky, beyond the reach of sight. Performance limit, white on atmospheric white, a situation where the body can only refer to itself and no longer to the Edenic vision of the mantle. The mantle is object and body at the same time. And further on, in the same note, the mantle object dissolves itself into the mantle space, that is, space environment, end quote. So now I'm just going to briefly, because the document has several pages, and I'm just going to briefly run through the contents of the remaining pages so that you get a feel of how vast the references that Oiticica was making in terms of the this idea of the nest and the feathered mantle and so on. So in page 2 of the same document, Oiticica invokes an incident with a fan at a Rolling Stones concert. In page 3, it is with the Parangolés that the Agomoro is associated with. Page 4 discusses the relationship between the mantle, space, and clothing in the context of the rock concert, using Mick Jagger as an example of body environment. While in page 5, the concept of mantle is concluded as body climax, body wise, wise like rock. Page 6 sees a precedent in Ligia Clark's Nostalgia do Corpo, Nostalgia for the Body. And finally, pages 7 and 8 refer to Vitor Conti's rubbing piece as a body performance whereby the body is instituted within the performance event, a performance that embodies itself as time duration, according to Oiticica. The document, in establishing broad relationships between the Agomoro, Oiticica's past production, as well as that of his peers, his contemporaries such as Vitor Conti, and his enthusiasm for rock music and culture, reveals a will to build associations between his immediate surroundings and interests and his previous creative trajectory. The invocation of the notion of time duration is perhaps the most obvious confirmation of this hypothesis. Time duration refers, of course, to Oiticica's early reflections on how his penetrables, his kind of cabins, how he named these kind of cabin structures, responded to Bergson's notion of duration as a form of apprehending color. Despite its stream of consciousness style, or perhaps precisely due to it, one is reminded of Sousa Andrade's character, Ughese Hanchi, traversing space and time together with the image of synesthesia invoked by the Agomoro. That same year, 1973, Silviano Santiago describes Caetano Veloso's performative character as a synthetic character that was being presented by the art of Glauber Rocha, the film director, Zé Celso, the theater director, Hélio Oiticica, and Rubens Gershman, another artist who actually designed the cover of that historic Tropicália album, concluding that Caetano, I quote, wanted his body, its plasticity, to capture the public so that it would be the live image of his artistic message, unquote. Interestingly, the idea of synthesis emerges in Oiticica's own re-evaluation of the parangolé during the 1970s, not through any parangolé, but one dedicated to Haroldo de Campos and inspired on the Agomoro. Place is also significant here, as Oiticica seems particularly concerned with the relation that this new parangolé, this parangolé synthesis, as he called it, has had with the urban fabric, with New York, with Wall Street, perhaps. If we return to Haroldo de Campos' initial recording in Helio Tape 1, he speaks of synesthesia, the exchange experience between sight and smell. It is my contention that Oiticica's notion of experiencing color as music, or music as a tactile spatial entity, emerges from this encounter with the Japanese Noh Theater, Agomoro. In 1977, still in New York, we find Oiticica making quite a significant statement, that all his previous work was but a prelude for what was to come. This critical reassessment of his trajectory would incorporate his experiences in the 60s, from the Penetrables, the Parangolé to Tropicália, together with the influence gathered by his proximity to the Campos brothers during the 1970s, to experimental filmmaking from Jack Smith to his own quasi-cinema Cosmococca proposals, and his enthusiasm for rock music, the Rolling Stones and Jimi Hendrix in particular. The conjunction of these factors would inform his somewhat mysterious claim that what I do is music, o que faço é música. The statement is generally credited by Oiticica scholars to an article dated 1979 in which Oiticica claims, and I quote, I discovered that what I do is music and that music is not one of the arts, but a synthesis of the consequence of the discovery of the body. That is why rock, for example, has become important for me to put into checkmate the key issues of creation. Samba, in which I was initiated, came together with the discovery of in the early 60s. Parangolé and dance were born together, and it is impossible to separate them. Rock is the phenomenal planetary synthesis of the discovery of the body. An earlier mention exists and is perhaps more revealing still. I begin this small notebook on the 7th of August, 1978, Caetano's birthday, and therefore I dedicate it to him, the poet. 4:50 p.m., to the sound of the Rolling Stones on the hi-fi. Wrong. Wrong remote. Something had to go wrong. CD's not playing, never mind. So, 4:50 p.m. to the sound of the Rolling Stones, I just named this penetrable PN Magic Square 3, which I'm completing. It's titled Brown Sugar, O que faço é música. This penetrable is my rock of the day. It is not that what I do, or this penetrable has the spirit of rock, or that it is musical. It is rock. The invention of color is rock, and there is more. Rock is important because rock is always a state of invention, just as what I do is music and never a finished work of art. The invention of color is invention, it is music. Brown Sugar, Magic Square 3 is rock, just as Bach's fugue is the invention of art, unquote. To understand Oiticica's return to the investigation of color within space in the Magic Square series represents therefore a synthesis of his interest in the Bergsonian notion of duration and the rethinking of the significance of the relation between the parangolé and dance, now demythified from its primitivist connotations that had been so much invoked by the artist himself through the association with the favela. This would become possible via the synesthetic image of the agomoro, which bridges space, touch, and smell through the synthetic notion of the body and music. During the neoconcrete years in the early 60s, very early 60s, Oiticica wrote about the Penetrables as primarily concerned with color. Drawing on Bergson, he saw silence emanating from within the work. And since silence can only be perceived as time, the work of art became inescapably associated with duration. In his view, it became duration. With the later Penetrable projects of the 1970s, with the artist now exiled from the aesthetic laboratory of neoconcretism, as Ronaldo Brito defined the movement, and the subsequent brutal clash of the favela with mass popular media, for Oiticica, now the New Yorker, or New Yorkese, a title he gave his early New York Penetrables around 1971, the notion of duration became noise, music. Silence was replaced by rock and roll. During his lifetime, these works remained as projects, maquettes to be built one day in public squares within the urban fabric of the city. Two versions of the same magic square, which you see here, magic square number 5, have been built. One in the Museu do Açude in Rio de Janeiro's Parque da Tijuca, the other at Inhotim, mining billionaire Bernardo Paz's answer to North American philanthropy and European public-private models of arts funding. Brazil experienced during the 1970s an economic boom, the so-called Brazilian miracle. Regarding the commercial appropriation by the music industry that transformed Tropicália into a brand name, Tropicalismo, and the concurrent slogans promoted by the military regime, such as Brazil, love it or leave it, Oiticica responded with an essay entitled Brazil Diarrhea. I wonder what he would have made of this second Brazilian miracle, which we hear about today, and how his own work has come to figure within the booming world of contemporary art. Whichever the case, whether slowly being taken over by the tropical surrounding and the lack of maintenance, or, as in Inhotim, immaculately preserved, that showcase for the power of Inhotim, the showcase for the power associated with collecting that has come to dominate the contemporary art world, these Penetrables seem to stand again in silence. Thank you very much. I'm happy to answer questions. And we have a microphone, by the way, which, as we're recording, I'd ask you to please wait until it arrives.
While you are thinking, I have a question about Hagoromo.
Uh-huh.
You have to pronounce the H, see. It's Hagoromo.
Hagoromo.
Yes. Hagoromo, I didn't understand.
Yeah.
It's interesting that after that print, particularly is Hagoromo story, but I don't think that is from the North scene. But just my comment is more like how the North Theatre itself becomes suddenly quite a cultural, because North Theatre itself is quite an exotic thing, even in Japan. How many Japanese are here?
What?
How many have actually seen North Theatre in life? Okay, lots of non-Japanese hands going. Excellent. But particularly in the 60s, there is a certain interest in that. Also, another interesting example is Benjamin Britten's Curry River, where he early on he traveled to Asia and particularly famous that incorporated a lot of Gamelan music. but in Japan he actually saw an old theater called Sumidagawa and he incorporated more or less the entire story into his church panel of Kauri River, which is, I love it. I mean, just I think it's one of his best things. Again, he incorporated not only the sort of musically and the story, but how because it's supposed to happen in, not in a theater, but in a church, where you have sort of the seats and in the middle, and then this mad woman, you know, this big pit appears, and then with a very high voice, this sort of spine-chilling really, sort of walks through. It's really also in the space and the movement, Kauri River also incorporates sort of North thing and creates some kind of hybrid cultural product. That's what I was very interested in, just almost immediately. Oiticica also takes it from probably Britain or Oiticica never met. Yeah. Okay. Any questions?
It's funny how the play arrives at Oiticica kind of via Ezra Pound.
Yes.
Through the Campos brothers. And then.
Yeah, I think Ezra Pound is also very interesting. Actually, I think his importance is sort of underplayed because he's now regarded as a really arch baddie, sort of a Nazi sympathizer. But in fact, he was very sort of sympathetic on the not only Japanese but also Chinese culture. And his role as a go-between in different kind of artists, poets, and so on was extremely important, not only in America, but also in Europe. Yeah, and now we see this more expanding the sphere.
It's a really simple question, but I just wanted to find out more about the actual artwork, the structure that he's built. You mentioned that he's made maquettes in his lifetime, and then afterwards they've made it. But I wanted to find out, because that's something that he's only made the maquette for, but he hasn't seen the final result of it. And I wanted to find out, like, the implications of actually finishing an artwork and placing it in a site. And I wanted to find out more about I don't know if you can answer, like his way of thinking of placing an architectural space within the public area. And because I know that he tended to make work outside galleries to do with, such as his shelves almost, like that he'd be pulling out in his mirrors on the floor, which local people would interact with. And I was just wondering more about that structure.
Yeah, well, during the 70s, he made a whole series of maquettes for these, what he called penetrables. And very, very few of them have been kind of actually realized. He died in 1980, and he only became recognized as being a very important artist, you know, at least kind of 15 years. No, actually, his first retrospective was in 92, so kind of a good 12 years after his death. And but even then, it would be kind of the cost of constructing something like this would be kind of considered too high for an artist like Oiticica, but now he's become this kind of global figure in the art world. I think his instructions when he built the maquettes were very precise. So there's kind of direction of the paintbrush and the kind of the color and so on. So in terms of the actual construction, I don't think it's much of a problem because he was so kind of precise in the details of the kind of architectural drawings and the maquettes and so on. The maquettes were quite precarious, but I don't think the structures were intended to be precarious because the drawings are very, very precise. But I tried to be quite ambivalent, kind of looking at these works. When you look at the writing and the kind of ideas he's associating with these installations, with these structures, he's talking about how they kind of reflect or kind of they can be considered as music. And but I think that's part of the kind of the life that he was leading at the time, where there was this kind of. He was at the kind of cross sections of artists, musicians, poets, and so on, and his kind of his whole working environment was very much one based on collaboration and exchange and so on. So I don't think, in terms of the actual structure, it is kind of problematic in terms of the structures being adapted or so on. I think they're quite precise, or I believe they're quite precise, but. But it's more the context.
More a question of context, yeah. Isn't it? I was just thinking, it's quite interesting how the work survives. And what survives, and this idea of architecture being this thing that is permanent and that survives people, and this is an example, or this didn't even survive him, this is after him.
Yes.
But it's the symbol in this kind of pristine context. And but I think another way that Oiticica's art survives is through perhaps other artists who try to kind of reenact what he did. And I have in mind particularly a work of this artist called Paulo Nazaré, mm-hmm. who's just...
Who's much younger.
Who is younger, who is of a younger generation.
He's probably in his
20s. Yeah, 30s. Yeah. But who just made this trip, you know, from Brazil to America on foot. Mm. And and also his graphic language is very much kind of, you know, surviving or kind of revisiting Oiticica's language and so on. So I think it's quite interesting that there are these two, you could think of these two aspects, like the architectural aspect of Oiticica's work or the constructive aspect of Oiticica's work and the performative aspect of Oiticica's work and where, in which context they exist. Yeah.
But in all those aspects, I think the collaborative aspect of his work is the most, it's the one that's being mostly lost. Like Paulo Nazaré is doing this by himself, and he's the kind of context that existed in the 60s and 70s, where people would kind of exchange and I'll take this the name of your installation for the title of my album or the track, my song, and a theatre play becomes the name of an exhibition, and this kind of this idea of all the different media kind of interacting like the people were interacting.
Although you could argue that in his work, in Paulo Nazaré's work, there is an interaction on a much more kind of popular level because, for instance, during his trip, in his documentation, he includes people in the work and he includes sentences taken by the guy he met in the farm and so on. And this all becomes part of the objects that he creates and the blog that he writes and so on. But perhaps in Oiticica's time, it was more of a kind of an artistic,
intellectual
group, and now maybe he's kind of spreading it, which is something that I think you could argue is relevant in a global, in a more kind of. I don't know.
As an art historian, I'm skeptical.
Fair enough.
How far did he know Max Bill?
Oh, of course he knew Max Bill. Yeah. I don't know if he knew him personally. Mm. I think he was a bit too young. Max Bill, he won the first international prize for sculpture at the 1951 São Paulo Biennial, and he came to give lectures in Brazil in 53. But as we saw in that photograph of 57, I think Hélio was 17 then, so he maybe hadn't met Max Bill personally, but he most certainly knew about Max Bill's work.
His works,
As a kind of, he was referred to throughout the kind of all the writing on concrete art, so it was Max Bill was very much present within the discourse that from where Oiticica emerged.
Mm-hmm. Any more?
Could you say again where this was?
That's at Inhotim. This kind of it's almost a surreal parks, kind of installation park, which funded by this multi-millionaire or billionaire mining guy who collects installation. So, I mean, it's unbelievably over the top, the place. He builds a huge pavilion for one work, and he has works by most of the kind of the principal artists from Brazil, like Silvio Meirelles, Tunga, Hélio Oiticica, and then kind of other Latin American and beyond. It's pretty unbelievably over the top.
But it's in Minas Gerais?
Yes, it's in the middle of nowhere. It's right, it is. No, it's not only in Minas, it's not Minas Gerais, but it's very far away from any major city.
It's very isolated.
Yeah, yeah.
And that would be completely out of keeping with Oiticica's wishes for placing this for...
I don't know. Because
was,
if you...
Was this not still going to put them into the slum areas?
No, I think with these, the idea was to place them in urban environments. Yeah, well, yeah, it's not a pastoral work, let's put it that way. but I don't know if he would agree or not. I mean, he said exhibition, not me, and then he...